a Hall effect, which everybody knows. But this was not the actually exciting thing, because people try to measure Hall effect in different other, in some other kind of materials also. So let's see what was that. So next slide. So this was the interesting experiment, or you can say interesting result, which excited all other physics community that why this is coming and why all these things are happening. So what they have done is that they shrink so here this thing is showing for zinc selenide. So they shrink this zinc selenide in a kind of 2D material, which is a kind of nanomaterial, some quintuple layer. So that means it's kind of 2 nanometer or 3 nanometer, that means less than 5 nanometer. So important thing is you have to restrict the movement of electrons in a plane. That means it cannot move, these electrons should not move in Z direction. So you can do this by shrinking your material dimensions. So once you shrink this material dimensions to ultra thin regime, and now you measure the same Hall thing, that means the Hall coefficient which we measured before. Now see this figure. Both the things, that means your rho xx and your rho xy, that means the normal resistivity and your Hall resistivity, both, they are giving some plateaus, they are giving some levels going up and down, but in a certain fashion. So now people are amazed that why these things are coming. So this was actually a kind of experiment, although these experiments were done on so many other topological insulators, that why these things are coming. What is the main role which is kind of creating these kind of plateaus, which are called Landau levels actually, that why these things are coming, why this Hall resistivity is quantized now, why it is not straight, why it is not saturating, and why these bumps are coming in normal resistivity. So let's understand this thing. So you can see in the right figure, which is showing the edge states and this magnetic field direction and this curly motion. So this curly motion is for electrons. So you see your electrons are confined in a plane, so it cannot move. And once you apply your magnetic field, so you see, due to this external magnetic field, because electron is already charged, they will try to rotate in a kind of circular motion, which is a kind of cyclotron motion, you can say. In physics community, you can say this is a cyclotron motion. So this cyclotron motion is actually trying to help all these things, because the basic fundamental, now again, this quantum mechanics is important to understand this concept, that anything which is rotating in a periodic fashion, in a periodic way, if it is rotating in a periodic fashion, like an electron is rotating around the nucleus in an atom, so their energy levels will be quantized. This is a fundamental concept, the fundamental thing of quantum mechanics, that if anything is moving in a periodic fashion, then it is its energy levels are quantized. And these energy levels, so in the center you see these all electrons are confined in this cyclotron motion. But once you reach to the edge, so you see the edge, at the edge these electrons are trying to skip these cyclotron motion and they're trying to migrate. That means they try to conduct the electricity. And the important thing is that they are opposite to each other. And the opposite to each other means that this property is helpful, that your electrons are in opposite spins. That means they cannot, so this is a kind of spin polarized current, so they cannot easily talk to each other. So that means your heating problem or your interaction problems, like which you are facing in normal metals, is now removed. And the important thing is, another important thing is that due to these quantized edge levels or the quantum levels, so the number which is defining this all these quantum levels is actually that was actually not well understood before, but recently, okay, let's move to the next slide, then only I can explain much. Okay, move to the next slide. So this was actually 4 years back, Nobel Prize given on this concept, on some topology, this guy Thouless. So once people were getting these all experimental results, that why these Landau levels are quantized, why this is coming, why this and that. So he was the guy who explained that this thing is also actually coming due to the branch of topology. That means something is not uniform throughout the structure. That means your surface states are behaving something else, and your bulk of the structure is behaving kind of a normal insulator. And he was the guy who gave the explanation. So these are some normal, some not normal, you can say some equations from his findings, which tells us that this topological invariant, which is called a Chern number here, that how to determine these quantum levels, that quantized levels, which is given by this number n. And this is actually accurate up to the level of 10 to the power minus 9. That means one parts in a billion. And this is actually a very nice explanation of all these quantum levels in Hall effect, which is called now quantum Hall effect, that this was also coming due to the topological effects in the materials. And important thing to note here is this cannot be happen in all kind of topological, all kind of materials. Like you cannot make gold 2D and just start to expecting that you will get quantum Hall effect. No, you have to make special kind of materials which are called topological insulators. So basically these materials should have their valence band and conduction band such that they have some gapped states in between that. So ideally their valence band and conduction band are very far away, like in insulators, but they have some certain gap states in some certain dimensions, you can say, in the momentum energy dimensions, where these electrons can move in certain fashion that they can conduct electricity. And the important thing is they can only move in same direction, in a particular direction. So they cannot just talk to the other neighboring system, which is a kind of very useful thing that people are excited about, that these topological insulator will be definitely helpful in future technology when we will shrinking down all our techniques, all our devices and all. Okay, so this is the concept of topological insulator and quantum Hall effects, which are governed by the topology. I have worked on these topological insulators and I want to show some preliminary results on these topological insulator based ferromagnets and interfaces. Okay, next. So this is one of very good example in which you can say you can generate some voltage with these ferromagnet and topological insulators interfaces, and which can be called a spin battery. That means you are not actually passing the current, but you are getting the voltage. That means your electron spins are creating some certain kind of motion in which these so in the left figure, which here I am showing ferromagnet and topological insulator interfaces. So here you excite your ferromagnet with some spin density imbalance using some external perturbations, for example microwaves. So the setup is showing down here, in which you are putting your sample inside on a waveguide and passing your magnetic field and using RF waves to generate this spin current inside your ferromagnet. So once this ferromagnet imbalance generates, that means it can generate your spin current, and it will try to hit, that means this spin current will try to leak out from ferromagnet to the interface topological insulators. And these topological insulators, which are enriched with these surface states, they are actually, you can say, accepting this spin current, this spin angular momentum, and their charge density, actual charge density, which can say, is trying to disturb. And once this charge density is disturbed, that means you are getting potential difference along the sample. And if you try to measure this potential difference, you can see that you're getting a certain voltage. So the amount of voltage or the quantity of voltage depends on how clean is your interface, how good is your interface between ferromagnet and topological insulators. So these are the things which are actually currently people are working on, and which we are also working on, try to exploit these topological insulator surface states and try to make good spin batteries, or you can say voltage output, using these ferromagnetic and topological insulator interfaces. Okay, next slide. So this is one of the result in which we measured this thing, voltage output, at the resonance of ferromagnet, and you can see this voltage is a mixture of both some kind of symmetric and asymmetric contribution, which you can say one symmetric, which is generally coming due to the spin Hall contribution, which is a normal, which is a quantum aspect of Hall effect, in which your spins of ferromagnet is interacting with the topological insulator surface states, and this charge imbalance will generate that voltage. And this asymmetric contribution, which is also coming here because you are working on metallic ferromagnets. So if you are working on oxides, that means ferromagnetic oxides, which are generally completely insulating, but ferromagnetic definitely, so you will not get this asymmetric contribution. But if you are working on ferromagnets, which are metallic in nature, so you will get these kind of asymmetric contribution also, but this can be taken care of by a variety of techniques. But the important point to notice here is that we measured this voltage and find out that yes, this topological insulator can be easily exploited with the help of ferromagnets and magnetic nanostructures to make some good you can say spin logic devices or spin batteries, in which output voltage can be easily tuned or can be easily increased with the help of interface characteristics, which is definitely a it's a mixture of some spurious contribution from intrinsic ferromagnetic metallic signal. Okay, so this experiment was measured at 10 gigahertz. So if you just move this thing, like if you change this frequency, your resonance point will definitely change, because as we already discussed, this all thing will be decided by the Zeeman splitting and ferromagnetic resonance. So if you are working on magnetic nanostructures, you will definitely deal with all these ferromagnetic resonant characteristics if you are working on high frequency devices. Okay, next slide. Okay, so this is just a comparison of normal metals. I think I am about to complete this. Okay, so this is just a comparison of previous studies on normal metals like platinum, gold and all, with the current topological insulator studies which we are working on. So you can see in this figure that this G into 10 to the power 9 meter per meter inverse square, which is a kind of transconductance, which shows that how good is your interface and how good is your transparency from spins from ferromagnet to the topological insulators. That if you are moving, if you are going from normal metals to the topological insulator, then you can see that all your transconductance is kind of huge as compared to this. So which actually tells us that these normal metals are actually reaching to the limiting case. So you have to think about some other exotic phases, which is one of them is a topological insulators. And this experiment was done using this experimental technique, in which you can see that this is a tabletop experiment actually at room temperature, that in which we placed our sample on the coplanar waveguide and connect all these voltage contacts with our voltmeter, nano voltmeter, which is definitely because our voltage signal is not that high because our structures are in magnetic nano dimensions. So once you modulate this external magnetic field and try to measure this output voltage with the help of nano voltmeter at the resonance point, so this whole setup is actually a mixture of variety of RF source and your lock-in amplifier detection technique, your diode detector, all these things. So you will definitely get these nice voltage outputs, which are actually proving the thing that your topological insulators are actually very susceptible to this ferromagnetic resonance experimentation, and they are helpful to take more and more spin to charge conversion from magnets to topological insulators. Okay, so I think this is the work which I have done, and can you go to the next slide? Okay, actually for this I need my slide. I don't know how to do this. Like this slide I actually deliberately make because if there are some beginners or some students which are trying to work on nanotechnology and quantum computation and all, because there's a kind of really hard competition going on, so whosoever try to have some good hands-on experience and all these things, please make their account on nanohub.org or edx.org, so that these all tools are completely free and very handy, and you can say very powerful, to give you a flavor of nanotechnology, that how you can control. So these all tools have are enriched with physics based tools, that means all your MOSFET, FET, IV based tools, your chemistry based tools, your quantum computation, your biology tools, in which you can even control your coronavirus and COVID thing, in which they have tried to mimic the change in nanotechnology, the nano drugs, that how these drugs, drug delivery, helpful if you are moving from normal range to the nano range. So these tools, please make your account there and try to use these tools, because I don't have these slides now. I cannot share it, but otherwise I would have just show you how to make these things. Okay, so with this, I think I am done with this. So thank you so much.
Dear participants, it's now time for interaction with the resource person. In case if you would like to ask any questions, you can speak up, or you can use the chat box, chat window, please, to type your questions, please. Sir, there are questions already, sir. Can you explain term in isolation?
Okay, so I think there were some propagation terms. So can you show the slide again?
Can you explain the terms in isolation?
So you have to show the slides again. I think you put that back. Those PPT slides. Hello. Hello.
Sir, can you explain the terms? Reciprocity slides.
No, Mr. Paul, I understand, but you have to show the slides again. Then only I can explain. Hello?
So there's a second question. Where do we see these topographic insulators these days, and in which areas?
Actually, Mr. Paul, can you hear me or not?
Yes, sir. First question is, can you explain
I can see that question. I am just saying, for telling the answer of first question, you have to show those slides again.
Okay, sir. You can instruct us accordingly. We will screen the slides.
Yeah, please show that slides again.
Yes. So we have to go a little.
Move back. Yeah. No. Forward. Slow. One more. Yeah, okay, this is the one. So I think he is asking about this equation, in which
hello sir.
Yeah,
so am I audible to you?
Yeah, I am.
I can hear you. I'm Sundar Patti from Department of Physics, MSc Physics from IIT Palakkad.
Yeah,
so I have asked the question that that IM and loss K, what are this called K and IM?
Oh, so this IM means imaginary part of your propagation constant.
Oh, good.
So that means this propagation constant is changing once you are moving from port 1 to port 2. And if you are coming back, that means it is changing. So I just put a negative sign here. And you are dealing with the imaginary part of those propagation constants, which are moving from forward to reverse.
And in that slide, sir, you have explained about the non-reciprocity of iterium iron garnet devices.
Yes.
I don't have that much of knowledge in nanoscience and all the things. Fundamental physics is that it should show the magnetic anisotropy. So does it show the magnetic anisotropy?
So you mean to say these magnetic films should show magnetic anisotropy, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, they are showing because. You just complete first.
I have used some ferrite materials. This is also magnetic anisotropy. That's why we can design an isolator or a circulatum, those things.
So magnetic anisotropy basically generally comes if you are working on epitaxial samples. So here you can see these magnetic anisotropies are actually helpful in getting these high isolations. So you see the sample which is on YAG-GGG is giving maximum isolation as compared to silicon and quartz. Because silicon and quartz samples, they are polycrystalline, so their magnetic anisotropy is less as compared to the samples which are on GGG.
And whatever said the absorption percentage of absorption and the through YAG materials. YAG material, they can also used as an absorbing material, sir.
Yeah, they can be used as an absorber also.
What is the percentage of absorption that we
can do? That absorption depends on the thickness of your YAG. So if you are working on some kind of bulks, for example, your thickness is in microns, 100 microns or 200 microns. So you can reach up to 50 dB, 40 to 50 dB. But if you are working on nano dimensions, that means magnetic nanostructures, so that absorption will reduce, kind of, you can see, 20 dB or even less than 20 dB. So it all depends how thick your sample is.
Thank you.
Okay. So the next question was, is there any possibility to reduce the band gap between valence band and conduction band in insulators? If you're talking about topological insulators, so yes. So what people are doing, that they are trying to dope these topological insulators with variety of other materials. So for example, if you are working in bismuth based, bismuth antimony or bismuth telluride based. So you just try to dope these materials to tune this band gap so that you can tune this valence band and conduction band difference. I don't see any other thing here. Mr. Paul, are you seeing any other question? I don't know. Because in my chat box, I don't know anything else.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, sir.
There's another question.
Sorry?
There's another question here. Is there any possibility to reduce the band gap between valence band and conduction band in insulator?
I think someone tried to talk with me, I think.
Okay, sir. And there's another question. Where do we see these topographic insulators these days and in which areas?
Okay, so regarding this, where these current topological insulators are working or where we can see. So the prime importance of these topological insulators, which people are working on, is the quantum computers. So I can give some examples. That IBM, Google, and this Honeywell, they are making this, or they already made these quantum computers. So all these quantum computers, their hardware is basically made up of very good topological insulators, which are working from, you can say, down to 2 Kelvin or even less than 2 Kelvin. So these low temperature environment will give you this higher conductivity and control over the single spin.
And there was somebody else asking some question. You can please ask the question now, please.
Yeah, I don't know.
Good morning, sir. This is Suresh Pora, a PhD scholar. I was a little bit confused in slide number 21, actually.
Slide number 21. Okay. Can you please go to slide number 21?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah.
Sir, I got confused here between the two diagrams you have left and right.
Okay, you want to understand what is the difference between these two, huh?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so why I put this diagram actually, that it is true that this ferromagnetic, so let's start with the left diagram in which ferromagnet and topological insulators are interfacing with each other. So you can see that whatever spin current is generating, it is transferring towards the topological insulator. So that means your direction of spin current is moving upwards, because your topological insulator, which have a very high spin orbit coupling, they are free to accept this spin orbit coupling, this spin current which is leaking from ferromagnets. So your direction of spin current is from ferromagnets to the topological insulators. Now let's consider the case. There may be a case, because there are some ferromagnets present which are intrinsically generate these kind of voltages without an interface. So now here, there is no interface at the top. That means there is no interface on the top of ferromagnet. So now, whatever spin current is generating, it should move towards some kind of interface, and that interface is already present only at the substrate and ferromagnetic interface. That means your spin current is moving towards there.
Yes, sir. I get it.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
If you would like to answer any request to pose any questions, please do it quickly, participants.
I just want to add one more thing, that again I want to request all the participants who are trying to work in nanotechnology or quantum computation, that please register. Can you go to the last slide?
Yes, sir.
Please register on these two websites, and please use, because these are the tools which are made by a variety of expertise, starting from IITs, IIT Bombay, Delhi, Madras, and all these Purdue University, Princeton universities. So please try to use these tools and get handy on the nanotechnology, this realm, and all these quantum computation, because in future you see all these quantum algorithms and quantum computers will be only thing in which you can work on. So start working on these things from now and get expertise on these things. So it will be helpful for all of you who all are working on this nanotechnology and quantum computations.
Okay, with this, we will conclude this session. We would like to thank Dr. Vinay Sharma from the Morgan State University, Baltimore, Maryland University, for facilitating this wonderful session on nanoheterostructures for RF applications. On behalf of all the collaborating organizations, sir, we would like to profusely thank you, and looking forward to your continued support.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Dear participants, we have the next resource person connected already. Dr. Umar Shankar is with us now to facilitate the next session. Sir, can we start the session, sir? Umar Shankar, sir, good morning, sir.
Good morning, Dr. David Paul. Thank you so much.
Can we start, sir?
Yeah, I believe we can start so that we can end at the right time. So I have no problem if we can start the session.
Yes, sir. So dear participants, on behalf of the Rajiv Gandhi National Institute of Youth Development, Chennai, NIT Jalandhar, NIT Tiruchirappalli, Seagate Technologies and Boston Scientific, we would like to extend a very, very warm welcome to our next resource person, Dr. Umar Shankar, professor from the Department of Chemistry, NIT Jalandhar, Punjab, to facilitate the next session. Before we get into the session, I take this opportunity to once again welcome and introduce to you the resource person of today's second session. Dr. Uma Shankar is currently an assistant professor in the Department of Chemistry at the B.R. Ambedkar National Institute of Technology, Jalandhar. He pursued BSc and MSc in organic chemistry from the University of Lucknow and obtained his PhD from the Indian Institute of Technology, Roorkee. His major research areas include environmental nanotechnology, green synthesis of nanostructured materials, nanocomposites, exploration of photocatalytic properties of nanomaterials, size and shape dependent properties of nanoscale materials, application of nanomaterials in environment remediation. He has undertaken various research projects with funding from IUAC New Delhi, TEQIP2, and NIT Jalandhar. He has, to his credit, published over 65 journal publications in popular international Scopus Index journals, contributed 14 book chapters, and has authored 4 books as the chief editor, published by Elsevier, Springer Nature, and Taylor Francis, besides publishing more than 60 conference publications and conference presentations. He has organized and coordinated various short-term courses, international conferences, and workshops. He has developed various courses in advanced organic chemistry at MSc level and green chemistry and at MSc and PhD levels, and has rendered guidance to more than 6 PhD candidates and guided several MSc projects and supervised those candidates. He has bagged various awards such as the annual membership of Indian Council of Chemists, CSIR UGC, JRF in Chemical Sciences, GATE in Chemistry, and the DST travel grant to attend international conference in Greece in 2011. He was presented the best paper award by the Asian Society of Research. He has memberships in various professional bodies such as the American Chemical Society, Association of Chemistry Teachers, HIM Science Congress, and Indian Science Congress Association. With this brief introduction to Professor Uma Shankar, I now request Dr. Uma Shankar to deliver a lecture on green synthesized nanomaterials for water pollutants removal. I now would like to hand over the platform to Professor Uma Shankar, please. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Dr. David Paul, for a very kind introduction. So I hope I'm audible to all.
Very clear, sir. Very clear, sir.
Hello. Yeah. Okay. Thanks. Thank you. Okay. So first of all, I am very much thankful to the Rajiv Gandhi National Institute.
Sir, in case if you are having any problem in sharing the slides, you can send us by mail. We will do it from here, sir.
Okay. So my slides are visible?
Not yet, sir.
Okay. Just a minute. I thought they are visible. Okay. Now visible?
No, sir.
Content. Just a minute. Okay.
Sir, you can mail us and we will share from here, sir.
Yes. This is what I'm doing.
Yes, sir. Sir, it's now visible, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. David. And my apologies for this technical glitch. So it looks like nowadays it is common. Okay, so welcome, participants. And it's a very great opportunity for me to interact with the brilliant minds of our country and also to share some of the findings and some of the basics about the nanotechnology as well as its applications. And first of all, I would like to say a few words about this program, because this particular program, which is based on the nanotechnology and its application, is highly relevant in this current scenario, because we are very much aware that lots of things have been changed in our life only because of this term, which is called as the nanotechnology. Lots of things have been completely, entirely changed. For example, few years back, our equipments, especially the memory devices or the computers or other electronic equipments, was very big in the size. You all remember the televisions of that time. But it is the nanotechnology, with the help of this nanotechnology principles and the nanomaterials, the size has been reduced. We can understand the size of a pen drive. Nowadays, we can carry like 128 GB pen drive in our pocket, but few years back it was not possible, and this has been possible today only because of the nanotechnology. So things are very rapidly changing with the use of nanomaterials, and the one thing simply responsible is the size. Okay, so these nanomaterials are very much important because they have unusual properties compared to the similar chemical composition material, which is in the larger size range. So therefore, this nanotechnology is very much important. And why we are very much focused about nanotechnology in the area of chemistry, because in our lab, lots of new phenomena are occurring, and that we have to identify and that we have to understand. When we understood better something, we can apply something in a better way. So therefore, this nanotechnology is very much helpful. We can see our mobile phone. It has been changed a lot in past 6 to 8 years back, right? So previously, our mobile phone was operated by the button system. Okay, then one discovery was come for the conducting polymers, and now it is the touch screen, and whole system has been changed, and now your phone is having color font. Their resolution has been increased, their slide, their representation, all kind of stuff has been changed only because of the nanotechnology, because of the lithography system where we are utilizing the nanomaterials. So we all understood the importance of nanotechnology, and in this perspective, this course is highly appreciable, because for young researchers, for master students, to understand this particular technology in a better way is the need of time, and therefore it is very much important. And my all appreciations to the various organizations who are involved in this course. And now let us come to my topic, which is the green synthesized nanomaterials for water pollutants removal. I have chosen this topic because this nanotechnology, what I have said, the conclusion is it's a new technology, but actually it is not. It is everywhere in the nature. In the nature, there are lots of phenomena occurring which are due to the nanotechnology. You are seeing these things like water repellent lotus leaf, vibrant colors of the butterfly or peacock, or the arm of the vehicle who can move even against the gravity. These all processes involve the phenomena of the nanotechnology or somewhere involvement of the nanomaterials. And these nanomaterials are so much important because when we move in the size less than 10 to the power equals or less than 10 to the power minus 9 meter, it has been found that a particular particle is behaving differently. Apart from the fact that if you have two particles with difference in the particle size, they are going to behave differently because of its size, its particle size. And it has been very much established fact that the properties of material are mainly the function of their particle size. And when we go down in the nano range, the similar same material may behave as insulator, or the similar material we can make the semiconductor, or we can play with the properties of material. And once we are able to play with the properties of
material,
we can synthesize lots of things. Yeah, I request participants to please mute their mic. Somebody has opened his mic. Okay, so the nanotechnology examples are plenty in our nature. Even inside our body, our DNA is of the having the nanotechnology. We all remember 2-3 years back, we had a Nobel Prize in the chemistry for the molecular machine. That means we have a robot kind of thing whose size is the nano range. It can go to the any part of the body, deliver your cargo and come back, or work as per your directions. So there are lots of things which are there in the nanotechnology, and nowadays we are utilizing. So for this slide is actually for the master students to assume the small size of the nanoparticles. Like from naked eyes, we can observe like 50 to 60 micrometer dimension. Okay, but if we go to the nano range, we cannot see, we cannot visualize the particles with the naked eyes. We will be in the need of some sort of the microscope. We all remember that if we want to visualize something small, less than 50 micrometer, we are in the need of a microscope. Okay, and a microscope is something where the visible light comes, passes through series of lenses, and resolve the image. On the same principle, another equipment was invented, which was called as the scanning electron microscope or electron microscope, where the light source has been replaced from visible light to the high energy electrons, and from that we can fully characterize the nanomaterial. For example, this buckyball or DNA or this carbon nanotube, their size has been characterized on the basis of a electron microscope. These nanomaterials are of various types. Maybe they are carbon-based nanomaterials, or maybe they are inorganic-based, like zinc oxide, iron oxide. You all might have heard. The important thing is that your nanomaterial is of what type. These nanomaterials are mainly types. Okay, so this is the 3D bulk structure, right? This is the 3D bulk structure, where all the three dimensions, okay, X, Y, and Z, all the three dimensions are in the bulk range. That means they are not in the nano range. If one of the dimension has been suppressed to the nano range and rest of the two dimensions are in the micrometer range, that kind of arrangement is called as the quantum well type of nanomaterial. And if in this structure you have seen that this particular dimension has been reduced, so we are end up with the 2D material, where the two dimensions are in the micrometer range, one dimension is in the nanometer range. However, if we again suppress this dimension, then we will get this kind of system, looks like a wire, where the two dimensions are in the nano range and one dimensions are in the micrometer range. That is called as the quantum wire. Okay, and if all the three dimensions are in the nano range, then that kind of system is called as the quantum dot. So this kind of system is difficult to synthesize because we have to confine all the three dimensions during their synthesis. So for the research scholars, you can check your material whether it is a quantum dot or it is a quantum.
Sir, your voice is not audible, sir.
Hello. Yeah, I don't know. Okay. Hello.
Yes, sir. It's audible now, sir.
Yeah. I don't know at what moment my network is off. So, okay. I am continuing from this place. Yes. Okay. So I was telling that for the PhD scholars, you must check whether your material is a two-dimensional material or one-dimension or zero-dimensional material. So to check this, whether it is one-dimensional or two-dimensional, that can be checked very easily with the electron microscope. But if you want to check the third dimension, you have to go for the atomic force microscopy or... Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay.
It's audible, sir.
Okay, sir. Because my screen, it was showing some problem. That's why I stopped.
Okay.
My apologies. Okay. So if you want to check your material, whether it is one dimension or two dimension, you can go for the electron microscopy. However, if you want to check the third dimension, you have to go for scanning probe microscopy. And one of the most common scanning probe microscopy is the atomic force microscopy, which is simply called as the AFM. You can check your material. Okay, fine. So this concept of the nanotechnology was very much popular after this legendary lecture by the famous physicist Richard Feynman. There is plenty of room at the bottom and an invitation to enter a new field of physics. So initially, this very great scientist, physicist, Dr. Richard Feynman has envisioned the concept of the nanoscience and nanotechnology. So here he actually wants to say that if we are going to understand the particles which are size in the nano range or size in the smaller range, they may behave differently as compared to the similar chemical composition compound. So this term nanotechnology was coined by the Tokyo University professor Norio Taniguchi in 1974. And apparently in 1985, the first Nobel Prize in the area of nanotechnology was given to the Harold Kroto, Richard Smiley and Robert Curl for the discovery of the fullerene molecules that was the carbon-based nanomaterials. So the next problem was how to synthesize these very small, tiny particles which are not visible from our naked eyes. So two approaches have been put forward. The first approach was the top-down approach and other approach was the bottom-up approach. So that means if you have something big, you have big particles and somehow you can reduce the particle size into the nano range. Or second thing, if you have the particle size even less than nano range and you can sum up the things and end up to the nano size material. So I believe that students who are working in the area of nanotechnology are well aware of this. So the methods which are come under the top-down approach, they are also called as the physical methods, okay? And these methods are arc discharge method, laser ablation, aerosol, inert gas condensation. And one of the most common method is the high-energy ball milling method that has been extensively utilized. While the other method, which is called as the chemical vapor deposition, this method has also been industrially important and most common method for the synthesis of carbon nanotubes. The laboratory methods are also very much important, which are summed up under the bottom-up approach. And in this particular approach, solvothermal and hydrothermal, these two methods are similar type of method which are utilized. The most common method in the synthesis of nanomaterials are the reverse micelle or microemulsion methods and sol gel synthesis. So these two methods are most common methods which are utilized for the synthesis of nanomaterials inside the laboratory. Also, the co-precipitation method has been utilized for several type of inorganic nanomaterials. So we will very quickly focus about these two methods. And then I will start the work which we are doing inside our laboratory. So I am basically trying to be more basic because most of the, I don't know how many students are master student or PhD scholars, but for the proper introduction and proper basics of nanotechnology or nanomaterial, these things are important because we have to go from nanoparticle to nanomaterial to nanoscience and then nanotechnology. Okay, so we are already aware that nanoparticle is a particle whose any one of the dimensions should be in the nanometer range, that is a nanoparticle. Collection of such particles is called as the nanomaterials. And nanoscience is the branch of science that will explore knowledge about the nanomaterials, their synthetic methods, their properties. That is all nanoscience. And utilization of these nanomaterials for the commercial applications or for the things for making something who can serve the mankind is the technology which are based on the nanomaterials. So first, so we have to be very much sound about the science or about the knowledge of that particular area before going to the technology level. So therefore, these methods are important to understand how these small nanoparticles are being synthesized in the laboratory. As I have told you, these are physical methods and chemical methods. I will briefly, in view of time, I will try to be brief. So the physical methods, the concept between most of the physical methods is that first we will convert our material into its vaporized form, into its atomic form. And from that atomic form, we can recover the material. We can recover the material utilizing some catalyst by adsorption process. We can have the nanomaterials. In the case of high energy ball milling methods, this is very popular method where the milling takes place. Everybody has seen the milling. Okay. So we are utilizing this particular method since long. So the milling of your material in between the four stainless steel balls, which are coated by the tungsten, they have been purged, annealed, and you will be able to get the nanomaterial. This is the very simple method, but the problem in most of the physical methods are providing you the particle size in the polydispersed form. That is the particle size of your nanomaterial will not be uniform, number one. Number two, they are sometimes not cost effective because they are consuming very high energy. Because to vaporize your material, you have to provide very high energy. For example, if you are doing arc discharge, you have to provide an electric arc, okay, which can generate the temperature around 2000 degrees centigrade. We all know the welding process. This is a modified version of welding process. Laser ablation, you have to provide the laser beam to convert your material into the particle, into the vapors. So these methods are, you know, utilizing the high energy, and that's why less cost effective, and the results are also such that where it is very difficult to get the uniform distribution of the particle size. However, in case of chemical methods, I am slowly coming to the green synthesized part. In the chemical methods, I have told you there are lots of chemical methods. Okay, so these methods are, you know, utilizing lots of things which are nowadays comes in the toxic category, because if we are utilizing some chemical, it will be safe until that it has been utilized in a justified manner. If we are over exploring the material, it will become a pollutant. For example, there are lots of pesticides which are being used by our country. Okay, lots of chlorinated pesticide have been utilized. Okay, and nowadays they are converted into the pollutant. Okay, so overuse of any chemical will result in the pollution. Therefore, all since we are working more and more to generate lots of nanoparticles, because now we are fully understood that these nanoparticles are having unusual properties, are having advanced properties. To utilize those properties, we are synthesizing different type of nanomaterials. And in this process, we are over utilizing the chemicals, okay, solvents which are toxic. So it has been found that most of the chemicals or solvents which are utilized for the generation of nanoparticles are not green, okay, not eco-friendly, and also they are having higher cost. I just want to tell two methods in the chemical methods. One is the soil gel method and reverse micelle method, because they are most commonly utilized. So in a typical soil gel methods, first you have to take a precursor solution. Okay, so in soil gel, most of the time people take the metal alkoxide precursors like tetramethoxysilane or tetraethoxysilane. Okay, so it's the method name is soil gel method. That means first you have to convert the solution of precursor into a sol, okay, and after heating or after aging, you can convert that sol into the gel, like Colgate gel which you are utilizing for brushing, like kind of thing. So this kind of this type of system you have to produce. So first this convert into colloidal solution into sol, like a saturated kind of solution, okay, then you can convert this into a gel, and this gel will have a definite type of system, okay, as you are able to see, definite kind of system, okay. And now this gel, this, if you directly dry this gel without taking any care or without any thing, you just simply heated this gel to dry this, its arrangement is going to be disturbed, breakdown, it will be solidify, and you will get a zero gel. These kind of materials which are having random arrangement of the particles, okay, you will be able to get the zero gel. If you do the supercritical drying, that means you are drying this system without disturbing the arrangement of the particles, okay. That is supercritical drying, where the surface tension effect and viscosity you can take care of. So if you do careful drying, you will be able to get the aerogel. This particular area is very exciting. Many people are trying to synthesize aerogel because they are very light, highly porous. Okay, you can see the arrangement of the particles are not disturbed, and therefore they can be act as very excellent catalyst. Okay, so these aerogels, many people are synthesizing, and these aerogels can be converted into the ceramics by simple sintering process. Okay, so this particular method, which is soil gel, is very much used to generate various type of nanomaterials. You can also synthesize films, you can synthesize fibers, you can synthesize aerogel, you can synthesize zero gel. Okay, so various type of system of a nanomaterials, or in the size nanomaterial, you can synthesize using soil gel. And simple mechanism here, just to understood, this tetraethoxysilane, okay, this tetraethoxysilane, okay, this is SiOC2H5. So this tetraethoxysilane first hydrolyzed, okay, hydrolyzed to get the cyanol type of groups, and after water loss, it will convert into the gel kind of system. That gel is going to polymerize like a polymer of this after aging, and once you will heat the system, it will convert into the silicon dioxide nanoparticles. Okay, this is a just representative example. If you want to synthesize titanium dioxide or aluminium oxide or iron oxide, you have to choose your precursor accordingly. So this particular method, soil gel method, is a very important method. But the problem is utilization of solvent, utilization of these precursors. These may have some toxicity, okay, and therefore these methods are not very much supporting the green chemistry. I will come to the in the more detail about the green chemistry. So this soil gel method is very efficiently utilized. The other most efficiently utilized method is the microemulsion method. This particular method is a very efficient and very much facile, easy to perform method. Most of the people involved in the synthesis of nanomaterials, they are utilizing this method in view of its simplicity and cost effectiveness. So let us understand this microemulsion method. So see, this is A and B. These two are immiscible liquid, for example, water, benzene. Okay, so if you shake them mechanically, okay, they will form a kind of emulsion system. It looks like these two solvents are mixed to each other, but apparently after some time they will again separate out, which is called as the unstable emulsion system. Okay, but if we add something which is called as the surfactant, which are having long non-polar hydrocarbon chain, okay, and polar head group. So these kind of compounds are called as the surfactant molecule. If we add this surfactant molecule into the system, it will sit on the interface of these two solvents and it will form a stable emulsion system. Okay, so we see lots of emulsion system in our daily life, like milk, ice cream, lots of emulsion system we are utilizing in our daily life, where there is polar part and non-polar part, both are miscible to each other. Okay, our milkman can dilute the milk very easily, and from that milk we can extract the butter that is not soluble in the water. Okay, so milk is a good example of the emulsion system. Fine, so in this system, if the amount of water, that is the polar part, is higher, this particular emulsion is going to form a micelle. Okay, micelle system, where the polar part is outward and the non-polar part inside. That is not of much use for the nanomaterial synthesis. But if the condition is reversed, that means if organic part is more, then it is going to form a system which is called as the reverse micelle. In the reverse micelle, the polar part will be trapped inside and non-polar part will be sit outside. Okay, so that means water to oil ratio is very much less. That means oil ratio is higher, organic part is higher. So these reverse micelle are helpful in the synthesis of nanomaterials. Okay, how they are helpful? Let us understand how they are helpful, then I will talk about the various type of surfactant. Okay, so these reverse micelle are going to be formed in your beaker. For example, if you are synthesizing zinc oxide nanoparticle, okay, so what you will do, you will simply take the salt of zinc, for example zinc nitrate, okay, you can add surfactant to this system. Okay, of course you know that zinc nitrate is soluble in the water. You make a simple solution of your known concentration, 1 molar 0.5, as you like. Okay, and another side, you have to got precipitate out this system, zinc nitrate. You will use some alkali, KOH you can use, or you can use any other base or alkali. So the resultant will be ZnOH whole twice. Okay, so for example, when there is no surfactant, okay, so the Zn plus plus ions are going to mix with the OH minus ion freely. Okay, so the combination of Zn plus plus ion with the OH minus ion is called as the nucleation process. Okay, and once the ZnOH whole twice has been formed, that is a neutral type of molecule will be attracting another ZnOH whole twice, and the particle size of the material will be keep on increasing, and we will end up with the zinc hydroxide. Okay, and if we heat that zinc hydroxide, it will convert into ZnO, that is zinc oxide, and the particle size will be most probably will not be in the nano range. But if there is presence of surfactant, what we will find, because of the formation of these reverse micelle, the excess part will be trapped between these micelles. There will be plenty of micelles that can be formed, and Zn plus plus available between this nano reactor can react to each other. So the possibility of abruptly combination of Zn plus plus with OH minus will be controlled, that is nucleation will be controlled, because now this reaction is occurring in a small space. Okay, secondly, sometimes what happen that these surfactant molecule can coat the particle to control the particle growth. Okay, I will explain in a better way after a few slides when I will discuss my research work. But here you can simply understood that these reverse micelle are responsible for the synthesis of nanomaterials. So lots of surfactants have been utilized, like cationic surfactant, this C-tab, okay, anionic surfactant, deuteranionic, non-ionic surfactant. These are the surfactants that has been utilized for the synthesis of nanomaterials. And most importantly, the amount of surfactant is very important during the synthesis of nanomaterials. That means if you are going to change, if you are going to vary the amount of surfactant, definitely there will be change in the either in the particle size or in the morphology. So you can choose the surfactant very efficiently and do the thorough literature survey that which surfactant property or which surfactant is going to suit in your synthesis. So the surfactant molecule once undergo in the system, they may form different kind of morphology. They not only form the micelle or reverse micelle, they may form spherical kind of system or bilayer lamellar flow. Okay, so different kind of system, cylindrical micelles, they can form different kind of micelles. Okay, and the result is going to affect. Okay, so that means if you are simply expecting that it is going to form the reverse micelle, okay, but since your surfactant amount has been varied, so it may form some different kind of system. So you have to check this, that at what concentration the micellation process has been started. Okay, so simply as I come back to the zinc oxide synthesis, simply, so if these are reverse micelle in the microemulsion system 1, for example, it is zinc nitrate, and microemulsion system 2, for example, it is the alkali solution. When you mix that, these micelles can also be mixed like that and they can be break down like that. Okay, so we may get the nanomaterials during this process. These all 3-4 slides I have taken from the lecture of Professor Ashok Ganguly, who is very well known nanoscientist of our country. So you can refer its NPTEL course, so you will get very good knowledge about the nanomaterials. Okay. Finally, in this synthesis of nanomaterials utilizing chemical methods, these are common things which are being utilized, okay, and these are the problems with the system. For example, if you are utilizing the C-tab as a capping agent or as a surfactant, okay, I have told you the role of surfactant, okay, then this may be harmful. So overuse of these surfactant is harmful. We can also add some reducing agent who can reduce the nucleation, who can reduce the reaction, who can reduce the rate of reaction. Okay, so for example, the vitamin C or easy solvent, ethanol, toluene, okay, or these kind of stuffs are, you know, harmful in the harmful category. Lots of polyethylene glycol or linoleic acid or octadecylamine, citric acid, sodium borohydride, okay, or olyl amine, these all comes under irritant category. Okay, so from this table, it is very much sure that whatever reagents we are utilizing for the synthesis of nanomaterial nowadays, all are emerging kind of pollutant. Some people thought that since we are utilizing them in a small quantity, so they are not very much harmful. I also agree with this, but once we are synthesizing a nanomaterial in the industrial scale, for example, since the zinc oxide has been used in the cosmetic industry, okay, all the cosmetic industries are utilizing the zinc oxide nanoparticles because it is very much, you know, safer material, and also it can absorb light effectively. It can improve the aesthetic value of a particular cosmetic product. So therefore, it has been synthesized by lots of industries. But the problem is that industry is synthesizing the material utilized, which are, you know, causing the trouble. Right now, they may not causing, but after some time, definitely they will create environmental issues. So these all reagents which we are utilizing for the nanomaterial generation are, you know, emerging kind of contaminants. So anyone can refer this paper. This is a very good research article in the Chem Society Reviews by Duan et al. This is rather 2015 paper, which has shows the concern. That means this table is relevant nowadays. So you people should go for the green synthesis of nanomaterial by Duan et al. From Chemical Society Reviews. So you will get much more information about the things. So finally, so from all these stuffs, we have find out that either the conventional materials or methods are time consuming, or they require high energy, or they have involvement of toxic reagents or hazardous solvent. So what is the solution? Solution lies in this. In 1998, Paul Anastas and Jay Warner produced 12 green chemistry principles. I believe that you all are aware about these 12 green chemistry principles, and they have enforced that any researcher who are doing nanomaterial synthesis either inside laboratory or in industry, he or she should take care of most of these green chemistry principles. It is very much practical that every time you cannot go for complete obey of these 12 green chemistry principles, but we can try to adopt as many as we can. Okay, so you can also go through this paper. Okay, so you will or you can simply type on Google ACS green chemistry principles. You can have more information about everything. Okay, for example, if it is saying that design for degradation, okay, that means whatever you chemicals you are designing, what if somehow you have to degrade that material, it is not going to harm our environment. Okay, so for example, if you have synthesized zinc oxide and if you are utilizing zinc oxide in a bulkier manner, then after some time what will happen, this zinc is start going to leach in the environment and it can behave like a pollutant. Okay, so these 12 green chemistry principles, you please go through. Okay, so the application of these 12 green chemistry principles in nanomaterial synthesis is very relevant. Okay, because we have to check the sustainability of the product as well as of the process, because whatever we are doing, it should be safe, it should be energy efficient, it should be less toxic routes towards the synthesis or generation of a compound. Okay, so I will come one by one, because I thought I have to bit speed up to complete the presentation on time. So this green synthesis is actually it should be the environmental friendly approach. Okay, of course, reducing the capping and reducing agent, the use of these capping or reducing or surfactant should be justified. How it will be justified, I will tell. Just go for the alternates. So the green chemistry is livable, energy efficient, viable, economic, eco-friendly, sustainable. Okay, so you all know this. So I just come to this slide, and this slide is bit old of 2016, but in 2016 what the scenario was, that most of the chemical methods which are utilized, like 90%, they were the traditional method, like sonochemical, thermal decomposition, co-precipitation, like that. Okay, physical methods were 8% utilized for the generation of nanomaterial, and what we have to focus, that is the natural method, that is the biological methods, were very less, like 2%. So you can imagine, if we are synthesizing nanomaterials at the industrial scales, then how much pollution or how much concern we are generating to the environment. In view of this, we have thought, lots of researchers are already working, and we have also started working in this particular area of green synthesis. Okay, so nanomaterial synthesis, we have to follow the things, but what we can do, we can choose some alternate routes or some alternate things that probably reduce the concerns which are there in the simple traditional chemical synthesis. So what we have, mainly the green synthesis we can do by two type, either by utilizing the plant extract or by the microorganism. So since I do not have any expertise in the biology, so we have chosen this one, which is the plant extract or plant part extract based synthesis. So most of the researchers have utilized aloe vera, Asiatica indica, that is neem, azil marmelose, citrus fruits, okay, curcuma lunga, lots of things have been utilized. And why they have been utilized, this is the important. Okay, because you know that all the plant extract or plant things, plant leaves, they are having certain kind of chemicals. So organic chemists have helped us to clarify the things, because they have already established that what chemicals are there in a leaf. Okay, so for example, if we take Asiatica indica leaf, so there are lots of chemical found. There will be terpenoids, of course they are there in the plant kingdom, flavonoids, polysaccharides, and lots of phenols. Okay, so how we can utilize the things, let us understood. For example, it is the Asiatica indica plant extract. Okay, so here there are various kind of groups which are non-polar. Okay, like CH2, CH2, these groups are, you know, non-polar groups, and also they have some structure groups like carboxylic acid, OH groups. Okay. So that means this particular compound can have the property like a surfactant. Okay. Because a surfactant is a simple molecule which are having long hydrocarbon chain and the polar head group. So it is forming the micelles and reducing the particle size by controlling either nucleation or particle growth. Okay. So these phytochemicals can also act as a surfactant, or they can also act as a reducing agent. Okay. So we simply taken the plant extract of these leaves. Okay. And used them in place of a synthetic surfactant. For example, C-tab is a, you know, it is also costly, as well as concluded by various researchers that it is having potential toxicity also. So, and the process of nanomaterial synthesis was also more costly because of the utilization of this. So we have replaced the synthetic surfactant with the natural surfactant. Okay. And we have, before doing this, we have clearly understood that they can act as either surfactant, or they can act as reducing agent, or may they act as simple compounds who are going to reduce the interfacial tension of the system. So all in all, they have completely helped in the synthesis or in the generation of nanomaterials. So let us understand how they can, example, if this is the plant extract, they can cover or they can cap the parts present in your system. For example, they can cap the Zn++. So now Zn++ cannot combine with the OH minus. Okay. So sometimes they can cap the things so that the nucleation control. Sometimes what they can do, they can cover the, for example, you have ZnOH whole twice has been synthesized, and now this has been covered by the phytochemicals present in your system. Okay. So whatever you will get nanomaterials. Okay. Of course, in the nano range, sometimes these plant-based surfactant are stabilizing the nanoparticles, because you all know that since the surface energy of nanoparticles is very high, therefore these nanoparticles have the tendency to agglomerate itself. Okay. So this agglomeration problem can also be sorted out by utilization of the plant-based surfactant. Sometimes we can call it that these nanoparticles are contaminants-free nanoparticles which are being generated utilizing this process. And also the second thing which is important is the solvent, that we have utilized the water as a solvent. Okay. So all in all, for the synthesis of nanomaterial, we have utilize the Dr. Paul?
Sir, your voice is not audible, sir.
Okay. Up to what moment?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. So I was telling that mostly utilization of these leaf extracts or these water as solvent has helped us in the generation of various kind of nanomaterials. I want to pay few minutes about the characterizations for the students. So my recommendation is, whenever you have the nanomaterial, first you have to identify that whatever you are synthesizing has been synthesized or not. Okay. For example, if you synthesize zinc oxide, so whether it is zinc oxide or there is some impurity. Okay. So purity and the crystal structure of any material can be determined by the powder XRD. This is very handy tool working on the principle of Bragg's equation, and that will provide you the D spacing, that is the interplanar spacing, and on the basis of that you can very easily identify your compound. And also there is a database which is called as the International Center for Diffraction Data, that is ICDD. So ICDD database can match your compound, okay, and you can have a clear idea that your compound is of what symmetry or what crystal structure it is having. You can also go, then second characterization will be mostly the electron microscopic techniques, because electron microscopic technique will tell you that whether your compound is in the nano sized or not, okay, whether it is a 0D material or 1D material or 2D material, okay. So the electron microscopy tools are backbone of the nanotechnology or nanomaterial synthesis. So one should have to go for the scanning electron microscope or transmission electron microscope. Okay, these two techniques are, you know, similar kind of technique, but with a simple difference that scanning electron microscopy will provide you the information about the surface morphology. Okay, however, the transmission electron microscopy will provide you information about the internal morphology, about the crystal structure system. The XRD data can also be complemented by the HRTM data also from the diffraction pattern, which is called as the selected area diffraction pattern. Okay, you can use UV visible spectrometer to calculate the band gap, as well as sometimes some characteristic peaks are also there for silver or gold nanomaterials. So you can also go for the UV, you can go for the FTIR to understand the functional groups like surface acidity, etc. This particular tool, which is XPS, it is very good technique, okay, to understood, to measure the various surface information like the state of the compound, what is the chemical state of the compound, what are the elements present there, what are the quantity of element there. So this X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy is a very good tool to understood the amount of element present as well as the chemical state of your compound. And this tool is based on the fall of X-ray on your substance. There will be the emission of the electrons, and by measuring the energy of these electrons, we can predict the things. You can also go for the zeta potential analysis that will provide you the surface charge on your nanomaterial. This particular property is very much helpful to understand the adsorption kind of process with your compound. You can also go for the BET surface area analysis that will also tell you the surface area, because in the nanomaterials, it is very important that the surface area should be high. Generally, we believe that nanoparticles have higher surface area because in the nanomaterials, higher number of atoms are there at the surface than the bulk. So surface to volume ratio is high. Therefore, we expect generally high surface area. Okay, but in some compounds, it is not true. For example, zinc oxide will not get the good surface area. Okay, so these are the general tools which are being utilized for the characterization of your material. Very quickly, I will go to these two compounds, zinc oxide and titanium dioxide. These two compounds or these two nanomaterials has been extensively utilized. One of the most utilized nanomaterials are these, and the advantage is they are biocompatible, they are safe, they are photoactive. They can show their activity under the UV light. Okay, their band gap is 3.2 to 3.5 electron volt. Both the compounds are having almost similar kind of properties, and therefore they have been utilized. But some people are saying that, okay, these are, you know, showing some biological toxicity and all. So all in all, the thing is that these two nanoparticles are most effectively utilized, and due to their limitation, the first limitation is they have low utilization of visible light. That means they will not work good in the sunlight. You have to have a UV irradiation source to activate them. That will increase the cost of your system. Okay. And also their surface area is sometimes lower. These nanomaterials like zinc oxide or titanium dioxide, utilizing this kind of photocatalysis, you all understand this curve very effectively. This is the valence band. This is the conduction band. Upon absorption of UV light, the excitation will be there. In the valence band, there will be holes, and these holes will interact with the water vapors and generate this OH radical. However, from conduction band, these electrons will interact with the O2 of the air and they can convert into O2 radical. These two radicals will attack onto some organic pollutant and degrade or mineralize the system. So this is a simple mechanism of photocatalysis that is very much useful. Okay. So these two compounds are very much used. Photocatalysis is energy saving, or they are cheap, they are sustainable. And if your nanomaterials are synthesized by natural method, they will be environmental friendly too. So initially we have worked on the metal oxide. We have generated various metal oxides. In the beginning of my research in 2015-16, we have synthesized zinc oxide with very beautiful morphology, copper oxide, cobalt oxide, nickel oxide, chromium oxide, various type of nanomaterial we have generated by using simple co-precipitation method, just introducing the plant extract in this system. And we have also found that our nanomaterials were stable, as well as they have very good morphology as compared to other one. And also we have utilized our nanomaterials for the degradation or removal of various pollutants. For example, in this particular research paper, which was published in 2016, we have utilized the nanomaterials for the removal of some organic dyes, and the results were very good. Subsequently, we have coupled these nanomaterials with the enzyme that is lacase, and it has been found that the shape of the nanomaterials was very much uniform. And we have also degraded the alizarine S dye using simple photocatalysis. Okay. Similarly, we have synthesized manganese oxide and removed aromatic amines. But very soon we have realized that since many people are utilizing this zinc oxide or titanium dioxide or these simple metal oxide, so there will be a problem of bio-enrichment of a particular metal by the overuse of these kind of nanomaterials, and it will subsequently cause the metal toxicity. And we are already very much suffering from the metal toxicity. We all know how this arsenic, lead, these heavy metals are harmful to us. Okay, so first thing we thought that we have to change, we have to go for some alternate catalyst. Very soon we have changed our strategy. Second problem with these compounds was that to activate these things, we are in the need of a UV or artificial irradiation source because of higher band gap, and these materials were also have lesser surface area. So we thought about the alternative nanocatalyst. Okay, so apparently we came to know some compounds which are called as the metal hexacyanoferrate. Their name is dangerous cyanoferrate, but they are very much safe because the CN ion is a ligand, and it is present in the inner sphere of the octahedra, which is very much stable. And also US FDA has said that these compounds are very much stable and safe. So in view of their safety, their high applications, we have seen lots of applications of metal hexacyanoferrates in the electrochemical studies, okay, in the catalysis. So we have tried to focus our whole concentration in the generation of these metal hexacyanoferrate. We have also came to know that Prussian blue, which is very well known dye, which is invented in 18th century, and that was used to dye the uniform of Prussian army. Therefore, its name was Prussian blue. So we were very much inspired about this compound. So we have selected these compounds for the synthesis utilizing the plant extract. So we have obtained very good result. We have utilized the Sapindus mucrosi or Agil marmelose to synthesize this, and the results were very good. We have found that square shape or cubical shape metal hexacyanoferrate, we have found spherical shape, we have found plate like structure. So various kind of morphology we have obtained, and also it has been found that these particles are very much stable. And after this, we have utilized these particles for the dye removal application. First, we have seen the dye removal application. Okay. And then again, we have found that toxic polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons are also being degraded with the help of these hexacyanoferrate nanoparticles. Okay. So you can see these big structure. They are very toxic polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. You all know that these polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons are coming in the nature because of the air pollution or from the various kind of activities by burning of fossil fuel kind of things. So these nano particles based on zinc hexacyanoferrate was very much effective in utilizing the polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbon. This paper was accepted in Journal of Environmental Management. Also, we have found we have degraded lots of PAHs since we have synthesized a series of metal hexacyanoferrate nanoparticles and applied them for this degradation of polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. Again, we have realized that their efficiency is decreasing, their reusability is decreasing. Okay, then we have analyzed and we have found that this metal hexacyanoferrate, because of lesser band gap, there is faster recombination of hole and electrons. So therefore, their efficiency was decreasing. Okay, so we thought that let us couple these metal hexacyanoferrate with the metal oxide. It will help in two way. One, it will use the lesser amount of metal oxide as well as metal hexacyanoferrate. Upon coupling, there will be some changes in the compound. And we have been found that once we couple the nanomaterial, okay, or dope the nanomaterial, we have been found that photocatalysis has been improved. And intentionally, we have coupled the nanometal oxides, which are having higher band gap, with the metal hexacyanoferrate, which is having lower band gap. Okay, so this will help the photocatalytic activity enhancement as well as tailor the band gap. The surface area was found to be improved. That means once we mix the nanomaterial of metal oxide with the metal hexacyanoferrate, the surface area was increased many times. So once the surface area will be high, there will be more adsorption of the pollutant onto the surface of nanomaterial, and apparently it will show the higher degradation of that particular pollutant. So the biggest success in this area we have been found, and this particular paper was published in the Chemical Engineering Journal. We have coupled Fe2O3 iron oxide simple hematite with the zinc hexacyanoferrate nanomaterial. Okay, we have coupled this, and this nanoparticle was synthesized by utilizing the neem leaf extract, and because the chrysine, which is very toxic polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbon, has been degraded to the H2O and CO2 with the help of this particular catalyst, which were found very much efficient. So this was very, very biggest success of our concept. After that, we have synthesized lots of coupled nanomaterial, like zinc oxide has been coupled with ZnSCF, titanium dioxide has been coupled with ZnSCF, and you can see that we have got very beautiful morphology. And apparently, we have published lots of paper on this concept. We have also targeted water pollutant like carcinogenic aromatic amines and utilized the metal hexacyanoferrates. We have also targeted the toxic phenols, which are in the sewerage waste. We have also targeted various kind of pesticide like chlorpyrifos, which is one of the most used pesticide. We have also targeted thiomethoxam, tebuconazole. These pesticides have also been degraded. Okay, and also this particular pollutant, which is bisphenol, that is being used by in the food packaging material, or this particular pollutant is in the highlight nowadays. We have also targeted this pollutant, and this has been completely degraded within 2 hours time with this nanomaterial, which was synthesized by the Zeen method. And this paper was accepted in the Journal of Colloidal and Interface Science. This is a very big journal. Also, we have targeted its another compound, which is nonyl phenol. Okay, this nonyl phenol was also degraded utilizing the green synthesized nanomaterials. We have published in this series lots of papers, and we have targeted almost every aspect. Like we have targeted dyes, we have targeted phenols, we have targeted polycyclic aromatic carbons. We have also recently proposed the removal of toxic chromium heavy metal ion utilizing the new catalyst, which are based on the nickel oxide, has been wrapped with the zinc hexacyanocobaltate. This is another category of compounds in the Prussian blue analogy, and we have got very good results. So all in all, what we concluded from the whole thing, that green synthesis of the nanomaterial must be promoted, number one. Number two, we have to synthesize the nanoparticles which are mixed or coupled. Okay, not a single metal oxide or not a single compound. We encourage the synthesis of nano composites. okay, and these nanocomposites may be in between the metal oxide or with another metal oxide or metal oxide with some other metal hexacyanoferrate. Or a better area is that one part should be a natural material like chitosan or like lactase or maybe some other organic compound or maybe some other polymeric compound, some natural compound. Okay, so many people are doing this. They are doing, and that kind of nanomaterials which are having one part natural material, other part is nanoparticle, they are called as the green nanomaterials. Okay, so now nanomaterials itself are called as the green nanomaterials. So we have to encourage the synthesis of green nanomaterials, okay, as well as we have to also encourage the alternative catalyst. Apart from these categories, we have to generate some new or alternate catalysis that can be used for the purification of water. So I acknowledge my students. This is one of my book which is coming very soon, is the green nanomaterials for the industrial applications. Also we have edited one more book, which is green functionalized nanomaterial for environmental applications. These two books are coming from the Elsevier, and work is going on, which is the green and sustainable nanotechnology. This book is going to publish from the Springer Nature. If any faculty member want to contribute in this book, he or she can contact me. So finally, I would like to thank again Dr. David Paul and his team and the team from NIT Jalandhar and JNU and from Seagate. I'm very much thankful. So I will be happy to answer if you have any query or any question in this.
Thank you very much, sir, for your extensive lecture. We request the participants to post your questions, if you have any, on the chat box, or you can unmute and you can speak to the resource person, please.
Okay, Dr. Paul, I have given my email ID. Okay. Purify air using green technology? Yes, we can go for the air purification, because nowadays mostly adsorbent which are utilizing for the air purification are mainly the activated carbon based. We can replace the activated carbon with the green nanomaterials because they are having higher surface area, so they can adsorb the pollutant first. And because of their photocatalysis, they can degrade that pollutant also. Okay. So in my opinion, these nanomaterials will be even good as compared to the activated carbon, and they should be utilized for the air purification. So answer is yes, they can be utilized for the air purification.
Participants, if you have any questions, quickly you can post them.
Okay, or I have given my email ID. So if any participants want to contact me separately, it will be most welcome.
Okay, then in case if you have any questions, you can directly contact the resource person. So we will adjourn this lecture. So we would like to once again thank the resource person, Dr. Uma Shankar, for his wonderful lecture. Thank you very much, sir, for sparing your
time. Thank you, David Paul, and my all regards to your whole team. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. So we look forward to your continued support in our future endeavors also, sir.
Sure, sir. Sure, sir.
Thank you very much. Dear participants, we are closing this session for now. And the next session, afternoon session, will commence at 2 p.m. Please note, not 2:30. It is at 2 p.m. We will start the session by 2 p.m. I request all the participants to be online at 1:45 p.m. itself, so that we are ready for the next lecture session. This session will continue till 3:30 p.m. So till then, stay tuned. Thank you so much.